condemned. Spirit, break out.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Andy, don't go anywhere. Don't go anywhere. Man. Kind of weird, right? Kind of weird, quiet. Man, this happened to me once before. Once before. Oh, God Almighty. Okay, so I love that last song, man. I've heard that song a lot of times, but I never really heard that song, you know? Candy's up there doing her thing, man. You just, I don't know what, like, just done, dude. just done. I don't know if you guys, a lot of you know Andy. Some of you may not. You're sitting in a church that's 5 years old. And just recently has he come back to join us here in town. But I was just listening to that song, and I wasn't planning on this. I was wrestling with God all day about Andy and having him maybe share something with you and try to make some order of this. So we're 5 years old, but what you're sitting in a family, is not 5 years old. It's much older than that. And back when God just really got a hold of my life and said, I want you to go do something, there were people in my life at that time. Very few of you were in my life at that time. Some of you were, and for that I'm thankful. But Andy was there. He's one of the guys that was there. This song about spirit breakout, I want him to share something with you, and I'm putting him on the spot. He didn't know I was going to do this, but there's this church was birthed out of something, and it existed because of something that was kind of going on in my world and in other people's world, and they just and so started New Season Christian Fellowship, which came and went, and then it was SNL Church, and that kind of came and didn't leave. We're still SNL Church, but we're a name change. But it's from something, and so when I'm listening to this song, and it just starts to stir this thing up again inside of me, and I want you to understand what you're part of. It's not just to come in and to sing some songs and to hear someone preach the Bible and give your offering and take your communion and go home. There's something more than that. You know, I shared this last night at the bonfire. We're this church right here, we are part of something that is, not to make a play on our name, but is revolutionary. What we're part of is not common, and that is actually being part of bringing the body of Christ together beyond just what's in these seats. Like, you guys are all part of this church family, that's awesome, but you're just one group in a family that spans the globe. And the only way that this really works is if we all love one another and work with one another and help one another and all that. So we're part of that, and it's being fleshed out in this group called Harmony, where we're bringing churches together. And as I shared again last night, that when we started this, it seemed like there's just been, and I'm not the demon behind every rock guy. If you know me, you know that's not who I am. But it seems like evil just keeps visiting us more often than it ever did. And so I just want you to know that it just comes. And it's magnified now because of what we're doing and what we're trying to be a part of. But I wanted you to know where it all started. And my brother Andy, he received a word from God. What year was it?
The original?
Yes. Yeah.
I think that was in
2007. So back then, Come here. I don't want to narrate. Here. You got a big mouth. Yeah. Here. Yeah, you do. Because we want to record it for the world to hear. So
what am I sharing now?
Your vision. Your what God told you he was going to do here.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I wasn't originally from here. I was living in Maitland, Florida, enjoying my life over there, active with one of the churches. My wife and I were pastoring a home church called Fire Life, and Moses was a very dear brother that supported the ministry and some of the people that were on this side of town. But I had no burden for this community out here. And then just the Holy Spirit really got a hold of me. I went to visit him. I think we had a meeting with some brothers and we felt we needed to pray. There were some other pastors, I think. But basically the Holy Spirit really just zapped me. I really got like blown away by what the Lord spoke, and he just said that he was launching a national revival out of this place, out of the Golden Triangle. And it's just been one attack after another. See, when God speaks a word, he speaks it, and you got to run with that vision, but you got to know that there's going to be enemies. It's not like, okay, God gives you a word, and then, okay, we're just going to go do this. No, there's always opposition. The enemy doesn't want revival. He doesn't want unity between brothers. But I can tell you honestly, it's been a challenge, and Moses knows. I still live in Altamont now, and every Thursday without clockwork, from Monday to Thursday, no matter what I got going on at work, I'm free every night. When it comes to Thursday to be here for rehearsal, something happens, whether my car breaks down or a job came up that I got to stay late, or Saturday something comes up. So Satan has tried, and I shared a scripture, not to get on a rabbit trail here, but you know, Paul talks about in 2 Thessalonians that, you know, the enemy hindered him to some extent. It's not that he has power over us, but for some reason, there's times when there's a hindrance. And it's been, since I've been back now 9 months here, it's been one thing after another to try to, I really feel part of the unity that God is going to launch a national revival out of this place. And I think it was 2 months ago, I stopped at the same place where we did the God party, which was right there in the parking lot of the, right behind McDonald's. And I was coming to rehearsal. I was running late for rehearsal. And then I was like, the Holy Spirit just really grabbed a hold of me, whether you believe this or not. I hope you do. It's right in here, actually. The Holy Spirit speaks to us. You know, he actually will pull us physically and say, hey, stop, son. You need to go right here. So basically, he stopped me at that parking lot. This was 2 months ago. And he said, I have given you the victory over all things. He says, I am restoring all things. And he says, the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ is going to come forth out of this place. So God wants to launch a national, not you guys sitting here are part of that. And you may see coming into this building as, oh, this is just Revolution Church. Here's this little Pastor Moses and here's your little community block. And God is saying to all of you, I want to use you for a national revival to stir up a fire. So please don't take this lightly. You know, Jessica and I have been talking in regards to the attacks that have been going on. This stuff is real. This is a spiritual battle. This is not like religion, old time religion, and we're coming here. This, when you signed up to serve the Lord and you made a covenant with him, that means that you're public enemy number one in the enemy's camp. That means you're a target just as real if you go to Iraq or you go to Afghanistan and you're on the front line against all this Al-Qaeda or the ISIS. That's how real it is. That stuff in the physical is a manifestation of what's in the spiritual. These guys are demonized, and that's how real. Satan, if he could physically come to you and kill you, he don't care about you. So God is telling this church, you guys are to be a part of a national revival. He didn't say this to me in Virginia Beach, and it's like, that's the Bible Belt of the East Coast. I was there in CBN and all this, and my heart has been, since I've been in Virginia, and Moses knows, for 5.5 years, I've been praying to get back here. And so I finally get back here, my wife and I, and just, we've been undergoing a lot of attacks. It's been a fight to get here every Thursday to be part of what God called me to, you know, to co-labor with my brother for the unity of the body, for the revival that he wants to do. But please, this is not a small church. You guys may see yourself as small little individuals, but it's bigger. God is saying a national revival that he wants to do out of the Golden Triangle. And it hasn't changed. It hasn't changed. So when God speaks something, we need to respond. So, but that's what he spoke to me. Who am I? I was just a guy living 50 miles away, enjoying my life, no burden for this city whatsoever. It's still difficult. It's not an easy task to get over here, but I feel that that's what God is going to do, and the people are going to step up to the wall to rebuild the wall, or there will be some that will just not be part of it. But those who want to be a part of it, God is going to, you know, reward you greatly. So I encourage everybody, please don't take a prophetic word, which is not just prophecy, because I'm saying it, it's in here. He says he wants revival, he wants unity. That's his word, John 17, you can read it. But that's what he wants to do here in the Golden Triangle, and it's going to get done. So either you guys really can be part of it and see it and love one another, or, you know, just pray until God gives you the vision. But anyways, that's what he spoke.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you. Oh, man. Hello. Here, man, you might need this. I know you don't have it memorized yet. Oh, my goodness. All right, I just need a drink real quick. All right. Now, on that note, I'm going to ask you to open up your Bibles. Tonight we are talking about worship. I want you to open up your Bible. Even though we're studying through Joshua, I want you to start first in Matthew chapter 11. That's where we're going to go. We're going to visit that first, but then, of course, we will return and spend our evening in the book of Joshua. But I want you to start there. If you don't have a Bible, there's orange and yellow ones all over the place. Just go ahead and grab one. The page numbers for much of the scripture that we'll read tonight for the orange and yellow Bibles will be up on the screen. If you've got your own Bible, I assume you know how to find it. So we just cheat for those that are yellow and orange. Well, while you're turning there, I want to give you a bit of useless trivia, but it'll tie in. If you're patient with me, it'll get there. Does anyone have any idea when the post office started? When? Date? You have a date for me? 1798, what about you? What'd you say? Okay. Well, let me give you some useless trivia. The first indication of an official American postal system appeared in 1639. In that year, the Massachusetts colony, that's a shameless plug for Massachusetts, where I'm from. The Massachusetts colony gave a man, his name was Richard Fairbanks, permission to receive and dispatch ship mail at his house in Boston. And he got paid 1 penny per letter. By no means was he getting rich. You know, they don't have like they have now with all these millions of people sending stuff back and forth all day, and he was just racking in the cash. But that's when it all started. But let me ask you a question. Do you think that the post office was were they the ones who invented the delivery business? Was it Big Brown, the Big Brown truck, UPS, Daryl Jarrett? Was it him? I know this is kind of, I'm setting you up, this is a real easy answer. Who do you think started the delivery business? What? Wow. We're in church. You always yell Jesus. Even if you don't think so. God invented it. He started the delivery business. You see in the scriptures back in Exodus, he delivered God's people from 400 years of bondage and slavery in Egypt to a place called the Promised Land, right? He gave them a place, he delivered them to a place of rest, right? The Promised Land. He also gave them a day of rest called the Sabbath, right? Right? So we've got the place of rest and the Promised Land. We've got the day of rest, the Sabbath, and this delivery, of course, began under the leadership of Moses. And then ultimately it comes to its somewhat of a conclusion, at least at this time, under the leadership of Yeshua, Joshua, in Hebrew, the deliverer, right? And that's what happened back then. But the Bible tells us in Hebrews that in these last days, God has spoken to us through another Yeshua. You know who that is? Jesus. Yeah, Jesus, Yeshua, the deliverer. And God's rest is no longer a place of the promised land, and God's rest is no longer in a time period called the Sabbath, but God's rest is in a person, and his name is Jesus. His name is Jesus, right? And this is what Jesus says, just to clarify, so you don't think I'm making anything up. You see there in Matthew 11, right? You're there in Matthew 11? Are you there? Are you there? Are you there? Yeah. Matthew 11, verse 28, look what he says. He said, Jesus speaks, he says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest," right? So you pause there a second. So the assumption there, like if I'm reading that, it's like, oh man, I've been carrying this on my back all day, and my back is tired, or I've been carrying the sack on my shoulder, and my shoulder's tired, or my legs are fatigued. So come to me, and I'll give you rest, right? That's what it kind of sounds like, but that's not what he's really talking about. And he clarifies that in the very next sentence. He says, "Take my yoke upon you." What? Jesus, why would you say that? You want to give me rest? I got heavy burdens. Why would you give me a yoke? Why would you give me more? Well, his yoke is not a yoke that burns you more. It's a yoke that blesses. It's a yoke that helps carry. It's a yoke that reduces your load. He says, "Let me teach you." He says, "Listen, you've been carrying this stuff forever. Let me teach you a different way. Let me teach you a different mindset. Let me make you a new person by changing the way you think. You got to look at stuff different." He says, "Because I'm humble and gentle at heart." And this is it right here. Listen, this is the deeper rest. It's not just physical. It's not even mental. He says, "You will find rest for your soul. You'll find rest for your soul." See, it's not just a physical rest of carrying something on your back all day and you just want to put it down because you're tired. It's rest for your soul. Well, what does that mean? How does that look? Rest from what? Well, rest from the cares and the standards of this world. You know, the world says you have to look a certain way to be popular and to be good. You have to act a certain way. You have to drive a certain car. You have to vote a certain way. You have to live a certain way. You have to wear certain clothing. Standards of this world. And he's like, no, let me teach you something. Let me teach you something different. That you don't have to do these things to be treasured or loved. Because I love you just the way you are. Rest from what? How about the Bible saying that we were his enemies because of our sinful thoughts and actions? And so this rest for your soul is no longer worrying about how I have to perform so he'll like me, or I have to perform so he'll forgive me, or I have to perform so he'll approve of me. Rest from these, from God himself. No more trying to earn love. He just gives it to you freely. What else can rest look like? How about the wages of sin and is death? And the Bible tells us, Jesus wants to teach you that the power of sin that's going to send you into hell for eternity for what you've done, it doesn't loom heavily on your horizon anymore. That darkness is gone. You don't have to worry about it anymore. It's gone in Christ. It's gone. So you don't have to worry. You can have rest for your soul. It's that, just do it with me, just this, look. And it's his air, like our song. It's his air in our lungs. We don't have to worry about stuff anymore. If you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the worries and the cares and the standards of this world and your desire to be good enough for God, it's out the window. You ask people all the time, "Are you going to go to heaven when you die?" "Well, I think I will. I've been good." You know, my poor mother, God bless her heart, if it was being good that got you to heaven, she would definitely be in front of all of you. I mean it. She's my mom. She's an awesome lady. I've never seen her have a drink. I've never seen her have a smoke. I've never seen her cuss. And I know, and you can call me stupid, I know she's never been with another man other than my father. She is a saint when it comes to behavior. And she believes she's going to go to heaven because she's been good. And I asked her one day, I said, "Well, how many goods do you have?" And she couldn't tell me. And you know, I have a crass way about me. I'm like, well, what if you were one short? Wouldn't that suck? I mean, it's kind of a giggle, but isn't that true? Who knows how many good deeds you have to get there? Who has the number? Do you have the number? Because I don't have the number. Actually, you know what? I do have the number. It's 100%. You have to be perfect. If you keep his commandments flawless, if you never do a single thing, you are perfect just like Jesus, you're in. I got bad news for you. Yeah, you're all out, including myself. No chance. No chance. So let me ask you, why are we talking about rest? Well, let's get back to Joshua. Remember when we first started this study in the book of Joshua, we're in chapter 1, and I told you, I said something to you, I don't know if you remember, I don't know how many of you were here that night, but I told you that the only way to truly experience the fullness of your salvation was to include in that experience the helping of others to experience the same thing. I don't know if you remember me talking to you about that. But let me repeat that to you. I wrote this down. You can jot it down if you want. The only way to experience the fullness of your salvation is to include in that experience the helping of others to experience the same. And I can tell you this from two different perspectives. I can tell you this not only from my life experience, but I can tell you from the scriptures as well. Let me just talk about life experience here for a second. How many people have ever, and don't do this to be proud or to have anyone look at you, but do me a favor, how many people in this room have you ever prayed with? Like you actually go up to someone and you pray for them, with them. Who's ever done that? Right? So you're praying for them, right? You're asking, you can see that they've got something going on, and you're praying, you're asking the Father of lights, the Creator of heaven and earth to come and help that person, right? Like, that's awesome, right? God, put your loving arms around them, right? You're praying for them. But let me ask you a question. While you're doing that, do you remember back when you were asking God to do this, to put your arms around this person, didn't you feel his arms around you? Right? Where do you get that if you're not doing it? Where could you ever get that feeling? Where would you ever get that experience unless you've been praying for someone? How about this? How about if you're sharing the gospel with someone, you know they're as lost as a golf ball in high weeds, you know they got no chance of glory, and you want them to be saved, and so you love them so much, and you start sharing the gospel with them. And you start sharing about where sin gets you. You start sharing about what Jesus did on the cross and how much he loves. And you're just rooting them on. You want them to have it so bad. You want them to have it so bad. And while you're sharing that gospel, you can feel your spirit just cheering them on. You're like, yeah, Miss Donna, get it. Get it, man. I know you want this. I know you want this. I want you to say yes. And while you're doing that, can't you sense, have you ever heard the gospel with anyone? Anyone? When you're doing it, can't you feel God cheering you on? Like, yeah, Shaniqua, go. Tell him. Tell him, my girl, tell him. I'm proud of you. Where do you get that unless you're doing it? That's an experience he wants you to feel. Anyone ever baptize somebody? Raise your hand. Man, I'm not glorifying myself. I'm just another man. I've had the privilege. God has given me the grace to baptize like over 200 people in my life. And still to this day, no matter who it is, I'm baptizing them. Their eternity is changing, right? That's nothing to do with me. I'm done. I'm in, right? I'm in. But I'm up there, right? And I'm dunking them, and I'm going, is this really happening right now? Like, really? You're going to use me for that? Like, I can't believe it, right? Have you ever felt that way when you're baptizing someone? It's their moment, and you're like freaking out, like, wow, I can't believe you used me for this. Wow, where do you get that? If you're not baptizing someone, right? He wants to include it in your experience. The other day, this past Saturday, we were over at the Eustis Police Department, you know? And we were praying for the police, and the police chief was there, and the fire chief was there, and the mayor was there, and the sheriff's department was represented there, and all these different people from different churches, and every different ethnicity, and young and old, and different denominations. It was just awesome time, right? And someone gave me the credit for it. By no means was it me. I'm not going to tell you who it was because I know they don't want credit either, but it certainly was not me. I was simply God's grace upon me to use me as the catalyst to get it going, to get the word out to the pastors, and they did it. And it was awesome. And it was a team effort. But I'm sitting there, right, at this thing. It was crazy. There was more people there than there is here right now. And we're sitting in this circle, right? And I got some lady, I don't even know who she is. Apparently my wife knows her. I'm holding hands with this lady here. And I got my buddy Bobby, the guy who you pray for him. He needs to come back. He's the guy who thought of Scumbags Welcome. He's part of this church, right? And that old Catholic thing, I'm gonna get him back here soon. You pray for that boy, right? So I got him in my right hand, and I'm sitting there, I'm on one knee, and these guys, these tremendous leaders from the churches are praying, and I'm just like freaking out. I'm like, I cannot believe that this is happening right now. Like overwhelmed with a sense of purpose and unexplainable joy. Like, is this really happening right now? Now, where do you get that unless you're helping other people get that too? You can't. It's all part of the experience. It's all part of the experience. But see, here's the thing. This is where it can get a little dangerous, because an experience, if not supported by the Word of God, is simply feelings and emotions. And you have to be careful, right? So I don't wanna just tell you this and be expressive and all that so that you'll believe it. I need you to see it in the Word of God. Okay? I want you to see it in the Word of God. So do me a favor and go back to Joshua chapter 1 real quick. We're gonna be in 22, but I want you to go back to Joshua chapter 1. I want to tell you about this whole experience thing of bringing other people with you to experience the fullness of your salvation. If you go to Joshua chapter 1, I believe the page will be up on the screen. Verses 12 through 15 is what I'm going to read. Hey, Scotty or Jerome or someone, can you put these spotlights on, please? A little bit where they're supposed to be. Thank you. I can read. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. Okay, starting in verse 12, read with me. You ready? No, not out loud, but just read along with me. Imagine that if we all read different versions. That'd be fun. Out loud. Blah, 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 blah. Okay. So Joshua's just been told by God, hey, you're going to go do this thing. We're finally going to cross into the promised land. You're going to have this big promise I've had for you. All this land, it's coming. We're getting ready to go. And so Joshua's obedient, and so he gets to his people. He's like, all right, guys, we're going to go. Here we go. And this is what he does. So it says, Joshua called together the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, and he told them, remember what Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you. The Lord your God is giving you a place of rest. He has given you this land. Your wives, children, and livestock may remain here in the land Moses assigned to you on the east side of the Jordan River, but your strong warriors, fully armed, must lead the other tribes across the Jordan to help them conquer their territory. Stay with them until the Lord gives them rest as he has given you rest, and until they too possess the land the Lord your God is giving them. Only then may you return and settle here on the east side of the Jordan River in the land that Moses, the servant of the Lord, assigned you. So what you see here is he's saying, listen, I've got a reward for you. I've got it for you. But before you can go enjoy the fullness of what I've promised and privileged you with, I need you to help me out here. I need you to go help others receive the same before you can enjoy the fullness of it. You see it in the text, right? I'm not making anything up. So you see it there. Now this is lived out and fulfilled in Joshua chapter 22. So if you'll go there, and this is what it says, and this is where we'll camp out. You read this at home already, right? Okay, I appreciate that. Thanks. Should I really get him? Like really hardcore right now? Can you all say slacker for me? Slacker. Okay. In love. Yes. Okay, here we are. So you see what Joshua told the people, right? And so here it is. They've gone through this whole experience. Now we're in chapter 22. This is all kind of coming to an end. And so this, look what it says. Then Joshua called together these same tribes, the tribe of Reuben, the tribe of Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. And he told them, you have done as Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, and you have obeyed every order I have given you. Very specific. During all this time, you have not deserted the other tribes. You have been careful to obey the commands of the Lord your God, right up to the present day. And now the Lord your God has given the other tribes rest as he promised them. So go back home to the land that Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you as your possession on the east side of the Jordan River. You see how it's all coming together now? Watch this, though. But be very careful to obey all the commands and the instructions that Moses gave to you. Love the Lord your God. Walk in all his ways. Obey his commands. Hold firmly to him and serve him with all your heart and all your soul. Okay, so let me just, can I just offer you this? Let's just kind of melt it down into a very easy pill to swallow. All that into this. Can I just offer to you that what we see here is a people that worshiped well? Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, look what it says. It says that they followed every command they were given. They didn't leave their post. They stuck it out with those people, and they've been careful to obey all the commands right up to right now. Right up to right now, Joshua's like, you've been rocking it with God. You are absolutely in his will right now. Wouldn't that be awesome if someone could look at you and go, man, you've been absolutely rocking it with God right up to this very day. From the moment you bent your knee to Jesus, you were like tracking with God in every single little thing. Wouldn't that be awesome? And that's exactly what Joshua told these people. They were worshiping well. They were blessed, what? To be a blessing. They never deserted the other tribes. They helped the others to find the same rest, that same blessing of rest that they had the privilege to receive themselves. And it says that they were careful to obey all the God's commands right up to that very, very day. But this text right here is more than just geography and history. In other words, it's not just about this one place with this one people in this one time. It paints a picture of what true, authentic worship really is. That's what this text is all about. It's not just some awesome story of a group of people. This tells us what true worship really should look like. Now look at your neighbor for me and just tell him, I want to worship well. I want to worship well. You didn't look at your neighbor. There you go. If we're going to pick on him, I'm going to pick on you too. Yes, yes, fair enough, right? You are so holy. You are so holy. Okay, here it is, and so humble. So let's look at this text. Let's examine it a little bit because we want to talk about worship. We want to talk about what worship is, okay? And a lot of times people think that we're getting ready to worship because the songs are about to be sung. We're going to get ready to worship, and now the worship time is over, and now we're going to read. And the reading time is over, now we're going to give. And the giving time is over, now we're going to take communion. And the communion's over, so now we're going to go eat. And we divide up all of our parts of life. And that's not what worship really is, and the text is going to tell us that. Let me offer this to you. True worship endures to the end. True worship endures to the end. Colossians 2:6 says, now just as you received Christ, so walk in him. When you came to Christ, what did you do? Jesus, my life is in your hands. And what is this text telling us in Colossians? That at the very end of your life, you should be saying the same thing. I'm about to take my last breath, Jesus. My life is in your hands. Just as you came to Christ, so walk in him. Psalm 37:34. I love this verse. I only like just discovered it a couple weeks ago, and it's like quickly becoming my life verse. Put your hope in the Lord. Walk steadily along his path. Steadily along his path. So I start here. I'm at the beginning of my life in Christ, and I'm on that path. And what does walking steadily assume? And when I get to the end of it, I'm still there, right? I'm still there holding on. I'm still there. You got to stay with him. True worship endures. It's not like, well, in this text here, well, the people obeyed, and that was their season of obedience, and they were serving well, and they were walking with the Lord, and now it's party time. I get to get my reward now. Woo-hoo! No. So that's not what it is. And listen, on a serious note, heaven forbid this be you. But oftentimes, people check out on God once they get what they think they need from him. Happens, you know, that was a yeah. Oh, yeah. Was that as in or as in me? Yeah. We do that. You know, myself included, I'm not excluding myself from this. But look at what the text tells us. that says that they had obeyed perfectly. Everything was going good. Everything's going good. Everything's going good. You did great, guys. This is what I told you to do, and you did it. And now they're in the promised land too. They're at rest too. But, I love that, verse 5. But be very careful to continue doing that. Don't stop doing that. Don't just reap the rewards. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. I shrink it down into your house. Bring it into your house. So you spot a girl, and she's pretty. You spot a dude, and he's handsome. And you meet her, and then you start lying to her and impress her, you know, because that's like, you know how it is, right? I'm this. No, you're not. You spend time with her. And you tell her you're going to do something, and you actually follow through. That was a good place for the ladies to give me an amen. Right? You quit calling other girls. You actually clean up after yourself. Amen, ladies? Yeah? And then you pop the question, and she says yes! Woo! And then what? Yeah, it's not spending time with her anymore. It's golf with your buddies. It's not, oh, you're so beautiful. It's when's dinner. It's not saying you're going to do something and then actually following through. You just keep forgetting to put air in her tires till there's metal hanging out and she screams at you. Then you call her a nag. You stop throwing away girls' numbers. You start addressing every single girl with your eyes that walks by. Oh, all the guys got quiet. I don't do that. I mean, maybe he does that, but you know. I don't know where you're getting that, Moses. What's wrong with you? And then instead of cleaning up after yourself, now you look over the snot rags on your nightstand on your side of the bed, waiting for the slave to take them away. Yeah. Yeah, right? What happened? What happened? So hopefully you understand what I mean when it says now. Remember this day. Remember when you came to Christ? Right. Now, just as you receive Christ, so walk in Him. Worship of God continues to the end. It doesn't end when you get the prize. You continue to the very end. True worship endures. Here's another thing. Worship implies plurality. That means that it's not just singing. It's not, and you know, we're guilty, I'm sure, too. We probably say it's time to worship, it's time for worship, it's time for worship. It's not right. The American church, especially, we put it into little sections. This is time to, it's time to worship. You know, you should have been worshiping before this first key hit. Okay? Worship can mean a lot of different things. It comes in different forms. It plays out in a variety of different arenas. Let me start here because we got a list here that Joshua gave us, right? We got a list of what worship really is. The first one there, you see it. We're talking about a plurality, different types of worship. What does it mean? What does it look like? The first thing you see him say is to love the Lord your God. There's two words in there that are most important. Love and your. No, love and your, right? He's God. You can't make him not God. The question is he your God? That's the big question, because he's God no matter whether you say yes or no. But you're here tonight to make a decision on who your God's going to be. He already knows who he is. He has no identity crisis, our Father. But we do. Just got that one. That was a good one. Everyone has an identity crisis except him. It's a decision of your will. See, love is not mushy. See, in our culture, love is mushy because we grow up with that. You know, hugsy, kissies, phone with your girlfriend till 3 in the morning talking about her shoes or whatever. It's not about that. Love, according to this book, is a decision of your will to make Almighty God the Lord of your heart. That's what love is. It's a decision of your will whether you will decide to put Jesus above all other people, to put Jesus above all other things, and to put Jesus above all other ways. Jesus is the love of your life. That is the only thing that matters. That is the ultimate question. And all the rest of this list, I would offer to you that if let me, this is going to sound silly, but if God was Delta, then this love the Lord your God is Atlanta. Do you know what I mean by that? That's the hub. This statement right here is the hub. It, Delta, everything goes in and out of Atlanta. And this line right here, loving the Lord your God, is the central hub, and all the other spokes are pointing toward it and out of it. And that's what this list all comes from. So let's examine this list, and let's see how we can love the Lord your God. Let's see how we could do it. It says here we should, you look back at the text, look at it. It says to walk in all his ways. What does that mean? Because there's a difference between that and keeping his commandments. There's a way that God is, and we're made to be like him, and then of course we don't act like him, and then he invades our world and saves us so we can be like him. That's the way it works. We were made to be like him. Sin enters the world, fractures everything, messes it all up. Jesus comes, and the Father's ambition, his plan, his goal for you is that you would become like his son. Well, how do you do that? It's not a command sometimes. Sometimes you have to examine who God is, and he says, and walk in his ways. Here's one. How about compassion? How about compassion? You know, I can't explain the Trinity, but the triune nature of God, it implies this community, right? I'm sorry. I was in compassion. I went to community. Let's start with community. The Trinity shows community. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One God, perfect union, all in the same plan, all trying to do the same thing, doing different stuff, always agreeing, perfect community together. That's who God is, right? Leviticus 26, 11 and 12. Listen to this. He says, I will live among you. I will walk among you. You see how he wants to live in community with us? Well, we're supposed to walk in his ways. He lives in community with himself. He lives in community with us. We're supposed to live in community with each other. John 1, 14. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. You see the community facet of who God is. Acts 2 and Acts chapter 4. The church first gets started. Everyone's meeting. And it never says, hey, you're going to live in community. Do you understand? No, you see that when the believer is actually invaded by God's Spirit, you see their desire to live with one another in community. They couldn't help themselves. They met every day in here. They met every day in homes. They shared meals together. They sold all their stuff. They felt like none of their stuff was their own, and they sold it so if you were in need, they'd give you the money. It's not mine. It's yours. It's ours together. It was community. Never demanded, but always suggested. And we're to walk in his ways. How about compassion? Does the Bible ever say, hey man, you're going to be compassionate? It doesn't say that, does it? If it does, I never read that part. Now, I don't remember that part where he says, you're going to be compassionate. But you simply read the scriptures, right? That's Jesus, right? He felt the pain of people. Not only did he feel the pain that people had, but he came alongside of them and he blessed them and he helped them with their pains. And that's the way we're supposed to be. We're never told, you have to be compassionate. You better be compassionate or here comes my wrath. It's not what it is. But that's the way God is. And we're to walk in his ways. His thing is the most important thing. So I never neglect meeting together. We're supposed to live in community. That was a good spot for an amen. For you, Andy. That's for you. Here's another one. We worship not just by loving him, making him the Lord of our life, but how do we do that? Well, we walk in his ways, and we also obey his commands. Well, there's one thing to walk in his ways, to see the nature and heart of God and to replicate that in our own lives, but we are to obey his commands. Do you know that it says 16 times in Scripture? 16 times, quote-unquote, verbatim, obey my commands. 16 times in that one book, God says, obey my commands. Now, dozens of times, it says things like, obey my rules, obey my law, obey my decrees, obey my regulations, obey me, obey the Lord, dozens and dozens of times. But 16 times, specifically, it says to obey my commands. So, what do you think you should do? Yeah, we should obey. Why? Because he wants us to, right? He's the boss. He says, obey. But remember I said that the central hub is loving the Lord your God, right? So there's an obedience thing there. He wants you to do it. But what did I say earlier? That all the things we do, will show that we do love him. And what does Jesus say in John 14:15? If you love me, you'll keep my commands. That shows that you love him by being obedient to his commands. Is obedience, I would just want to offer you this, is obedience worship? Let me try this. If I told you, I need something that I can throw that's not going to break. If I told you, oh my goodness, I got nothing. Yeah, I got a knife. Okay. So if I told you, hold on a second. If I told you, let me see if I can do this right. I didn't plan this out. If I told you, if you drop that, you don't love me. If you drop that, you don't love me. So, thanks. So if he holds it in his hand, what does that mean? If he doesn't drop it, what does it mean? That he loves me. You guys all agree? Okay. Do me a favor, since you all agree. Deuteronomy 11:28. Don't read 27, please. Just read 28 with me. You ready? You will be cursed if you reject the commands of the Lord your God and turn away from him and worship gods you have not known before. Now, pause and take this all in. What he's telling us here is if we reject his commands, forget obey, if we do the opposite, if we reject the commands, What does that look like? What does he say you're doing? When you reject it, that means you're turning away and you're worshiping something else. Doesn't that what it says? I mean, you guys read it, right? I didn't make anything up. You read that. If you don't obey his commands, you're worshiping something else. And I think that's wrapped up in what Jesus said in John 14:15. If you love me, you will. If you don't, what's that mean? You don't love him, right? Okay, so now, is obedience worship? Because in our mind, in especially in our country, it's you know, grace like crazy, celebrate grace. I'm all about grace. I can't get saved without grace. I get that. I can't draw breath without his grace. I can't make oxygen for myself. I need his grace. But obedience to his command is kind of like, well, that's the lame part. Like, I have to. It's strict. It's no fun. He's a fun sucker in heaven. I don't want to do that. But what this is saying here is that not only is it worship, but there's something for you. It's not bad to obey his commands. Look at the verse right before that. What does it say? You will be blessed if you obey the commands of the Lord your God that I'm giving you. You will be blessed if you obey the commands. It's not a fun sucker. Let me give you some idea of what the blessing might be in your life. Search the scripture a little bit. I found just a few. You can jot these down if you want. What happens if I obey the commands of God? Deuteronomy 7:9 says, specifically, if you obey my commands, I will lavish my unfailing love upon you. Who wants that? Yeah, right? Me? Everyone should raise their hand. Psalm 111:10 says, verbatim, if you obey my commands, you will grow in wisdom. Who needs that? Everyone, right? We all need that. Ain't nobody smart in here, including me. I got nothing. How about this one? 1 John 3:24. It says, if you obey my commands, you will stay in fellowship with God. Who wants to be there? Oh, yeah, buddy. I don't want to be out of that club. Here's some more coming at you quick. Deuteronomy 28. If you obey my commands, your towns and fields will be blessed. Your children and your crops will be blessed. Your herds and your flocks will be blessed. Your fruit baskets and breadboards will be blessed. Wherever you go, whatever you do, you will be blessed. Now, how many people in here have breadboards? No. What's that? Don't say, well, that's not for me for this time. That's all this is saying here. It's just the variety of ways that God can prosper and bless you. That's all it is. It's all he's saying is that if you obey my commands, I got you. Wake up, everyone. I want to pour my blessings on you. Just be obedient to me. I want to do this for you. That's who God is. walk in his ways, obey his commands. Here's some more about what worship really is. Worship not only endures to the end, but worship, true worship, is consistent, okay? You can see it there in the text back in Joshua 22. What does it say? It says, be careful to obey, love, walk in his ways, obey his commands, and this is consistency right here. Hold firmly to him. This whole section here where he says, before you go get your whole prize, but do this stuff. It should endure to the end. If that but is endurance to the end, then hold firmly to him. This implies it's a cry for consistency in worship. And listen, when I say worship is consistent, sometimes, I was just talking to Andy about this earlier, sometimes it's a fight. Sometimes you have to fight to worship, right? Because life is coming at you at 1,000 miles an hour, and it says Amtrak, and things aren't going good, but sometimes you have to fight to worship him. Who's the Casting Crowns? Is that who it is? I'll praise you in this storm. What's the words? I'll praise you in this storm. What is this? I wrote it down in the beginning. I'll praise you in this storm. I gotta have to sing it, aren't I? Yeah, I can't even say it. You guys know it? You guys wanna sing it with me? You gotta sing it with me. I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, and you are who you are, no matter where I am, and every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, and though my heart is torn. Yeah, you have to fight to praise him sometimes, right? You have to fight to praise him. Consistent worship from beginning to the end. It's not worship him at the beginning and then worship him at the end. He wants consistency of worship. Hold firmly to him. Just because you leave this building, that doesn't mean he's not with you. Consistency of worship can look like this. It's an Acts 2 meeting together daily, right? That's what that looks like. It's a 1 Thessalonians 5:17 of pray without ceasing. That's what consistency looks like. It's a John 15, stay attached to the vine because apart from me, you can do nothing. That's consistency. It's Psalm 145 where David says, and he covers the consistent and the endurance. He says, I will praise you every day. Yes, I will praise you forever. That's what consistency in worship looks like. There's no allotted time for worship. Coming to church on Saturday night ain't going to get it done. Worship doesn't end when Jessica's in the middle of the last song and says, good evening, revolution. Worship doesn't end once I get done here and walk back there when everyone leaves. You ain't in Moses' house by any means, guys. You're in God's. And we're here to worship him. So I just encourage you, when I walk, it's not like, oh, well, then it's time to go. Man, you get the privilege. Come on, smiles. The privilege to be in the presence of God and to worship him. Man, that's insane, right? You can leave this building, but you cannot run from his presence. What does that mean? Like so if worship time is over, right? The music's over. What am I gonna do? What do you mean worship? What am I gonna do? Well, you could praise him for the car that's getting you home, right? You can praise him for the car that's getting you home. You can praise him for the little ones in the back seat. You can praise him for your beautiful bride in the passenger seat. Ladies, I'm feeding it up to you on a silver platter tonight. I ain't hearing it. You could thank him and praise him for the family of faith that you have around you that prays for you and loves you and encourages you and helps you. You could do that. You could thank him for the word, man. This is my favorite part of God, man. I love this book. Love this book. You can praise him for the word of God so you don't have to guess how you should live your life. It's a lamp to your feet, a light to your path. You don't have to worry about what you should do. You crack open that dusty old book, and he tells you the best way to walk steadily along his path, right? You know what else we can do? Where's this microphone? Oh, man, don't get me started. Is this thing on? Hello, hello, hello. You know what else? you can thank him for? You can be consistent in worshiping him. You could thank him for the kids. You could thank him for your wife. You could thank him. You could thank him for something. Thank him quick.
Thank him for life.
Yeah, for life. Thank him.
Thank you for salvation.
Thank him.
My children.
Awesome. What else? Thank him.
His love.
Yes. Thank him.
Dying on the cross.
Dying on the cross. Come on. You can thank him. This is worship. You're telling him he's
for
awesome.
For a new day.
Yes.
For fishing.
For fishing. Come on. Yeah.
For Jay making it here.
Yes. How about that? What else? For BB.
Him loving me.
Yes. Come on.
Life.
Life. Okay, yeah.
Family.
Yes.
Oh, family.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, come on now. We can thank him. We're worshiping God. This is it.
Grace.
Yes.
For this breath I'm taking.
Yes. Awesome. For the breath. Come on now. What else?
His blessings.
Yes. Come on.
His presence.
Yes.
His love.
Come on now.
Grace.
Come on. I want to hear some ovation.
Grace.
God is good.
My family.
Yes. Come on.
My kids.
Yes.
For waking me up.
Waking you up. Hallelujah.
Stable mind.
Amen.
The call he has on my life.
Awesome. Yes.
Life.
Life.
Joy.
Woo. Come on now. Come on. We would have put a microphone in a rapper's face. Come on.
Friends.
Amen. Come on now.
Good looks.
Yeah. Come on.
Chains being broken.
Yes. Come on. Praise him. No, praise him.
God's love, love.
Awesome. Anyone?
No.
Anything?
He saved me.
Amen. Come on.
That place he has prepared for me.
Amen.
I have been redeemed.
Amen. Come on now.
The sufficiency.
Amen. Come on now. Come on.
Faith, patience, and unfailing love.
Woo! For like four things. That's good.
My
blessed.
Parents.
Awesome.
Family.
Family. How about that?
Ibuprofen.
Healing.
Praise him.
Forgiven his only son.
Amen. Come on, praise him.
My husband.
Yeah, Jimmy. Hey, that's it. How about that? You worship God. Woo! You worship God. You worship God. Man, hold firmly to him. Here's the last thing I want to say, and I struggled with this all week, on what to call this last thing. Because you see, they got a list there, right? We got through the whole list except this last thing. Serve him with your whole... with all your heart and all your soul. So this is what I got. Worship is everything. It's everything. It's everything, right? Serve him with all your heart and all your soul. And I think this is why the Church of Jesus Christ seems to limp and stagger. It's not because Jesus is tired. It's not that Jesus is weak. It's because we're not worshiping like that. We're not worshiping with all our heart and all our soul and serving him with all our heart and all of our soul. That's the reason why the church limps. All of your heart, all of your soul, all that I am for all that you are, all that I have for all that you do. Do me a favor. Last thing to read, Romans chapter 12. And then God's giving you, he's going to give you, listen, God's going to give you a privileged opportunity to worship him, to worship him. And before we sing a single lyric to that song, I want you to think about the foundation that sparked this church, that God wants to do something insane here. And from that we sing. From that we sing. Romans chapter 12, one verse. And Paul has it so perfect. He wraps up this whole thing perfectly. And I love the New Living Translation on this one. Because there's one little caveat in there that you don't see in a lot of different translations, but this is what he says. Paul's like wrapping up all that in the previous books, the previous chapters of Romans, he's telling us about this great salvation that God has given us through his son. And he says this, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God," this is the caveat, "because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Everything. Your heart, you know, Joshua was talking about the heart and the soul, these, you know, like, it's not the heart, the pumping heart, it's what's going on inside, the soul, the immaterial part of who you are, the, you know, your personality and your priorities and your perspective and, you know, feelings. That's, you can't, like, touch it, you know what I'm saying? Like, immaterial stuff. But then Paul reiterates here, he's like, not just that, but like your whole body. Offer your hands up to the service of the Lord. Offer your eyes up to the service of the Lord. Everything that you are for him. Everything. All of me for all you have done. And so I just want to take a few minutes before we're going to take communion here in a minute, but I want you to take a few minutes and I want you to consider all that he's done. Just take a few minutes, private time. Doesn't matter what he's done for anyone else, just you. Consider all that he has done. Because the scripture first says to consider all that he's done before you consider giving all that you are. Consider it first. Think about everything that he has done for you personally. Everything. Let's consider the all. And as you're thinking about that, I just want to tell you that I think worship can easily be wrapped up in two words, and I keep going back here, week after week after week, and I'll keep going back week after week, year after year. Worship can be wrapped up in two words, and it's my favorite verse in all the scriptures. Everything was created by him and for him. Everything that you are for all that he's done. Everything that you are for all that he is. That is worship. That is the only reasonable way to worship him, is everything that you are. Your time, your thoughts, your schedule, your money, your talents, your eyeballs, your hands, your spine, your legs, your prayers, just everything, everything. Complete, absolute, sold out for him in everything that you are and everything you do. That is worship. I need two gentlemen to come and pass these elements out. I'm going to ask you to hold on to them, and then we're going to sing. And I'm going to come back and I'm going to lead you in taking these elements. But this is what I want you to do during this time. Go ahead. You guys can go ahead and start passing out. I want you to be thinking about the all. This is what I want you to consider. Consider all that he's done. Think of the things that he has done for you. Personally, and then, of course, universally, like for everyone, this. But personally, what has he done? Think about that, and then we'll take communion together. Such great love you've shown us, that you would send your son to die while we were yet sinners. Lord God, I plead with you. I plead with you for every heart, including my own, in this building right now. For the heart that struggles to take all that you've done and transfer that into all that we do. And I pray, Lord, that you'll pull them over into that spiritual place of faith and trust and love and commitment to the mission of God. Help us, Lord. We need help. But we want to thank you right now as we sing one more song to you, Lord. And it's just one more song here, Lord. But we realize, Lord, that as we leave, that when the song ends, there's always a song playing. There's always a song playing. And you know, it's you singing over us. Woo. It's you singing over us. Help us to sing in harmony with you, no matter where we go, no matter what we do. Help us to worship you well. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing. I sing.
Your blood makes the deaf to hear. Right now, your blood takes away the curse. Right now, your blood heals every disease. Right now, your blood sets the addict free.